Is it possible to suffer shipwreck with regard to our faith? What are the risks that we as Christians face? In that context, I want to read from the first epistle of Paul to Timothy, chapter 1, verse 18. And this is what Paul wrote. This command I entrust to you, Timothy, my son, in accordance with the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may fight the good fight, keeping faith and a good conscience, which some have rejected and suffer shipwreck in regard to their faith. What we learn from this passage is that prophetic words that have been spoken about you and your destiny and about the destiny of the institution or the sphere of influence where you operate, even though those prophecies, like every prophecy according to the Bible, came from God, they may fail to be fulfilled. Simply because the recipient of the prophecy has suffered shipwreck in regards to their faith. I want to encourage you today to think for a moment about prophetic words that have been spoken over you or over the ministry that you are part of. And when I say prophecies, I'm not talking exclusively about something dramatic, somebody who is shaking and quivering and saying, that says the Lord, that may or may not be from the Lord. I'm talking about words or impressions that God placed on your heart. In that context, I myself remember as a 16-year-old kid, brand new in the Lord, but being secure about the future, with a passion for great things, but minimum ability to accomplish them. I remember preaching in a church that was planted by a hero of the faith who had moved away. He was a missionary from England, and he has moved away. He was very old, and it was expected that he will be promoted to glory any time. And the church was without a pastor. And the elders of that church invited me, little tiny, skinny, 16-year-old me, to preach. I felt so honored to stand behind the pulpit where that hero of the faith has preached the word before. But I was very insecure too. Lord, can I really do it? Well, I have no choice but to be obedient. That day, I preached my heart out. As soon as I began preaching, I noticed that they led a very elderly fellow into the church and guided him to the last row in the church. It was very obvious that he couldn't see. He was blind. He was being assisted by someone else. But he paid attention to what I have to say. When I was done, the lead deacon came to me and said, Brother Ed, come, somebody would like to greet you. And took me to meet this elderly fellow whose eyes were blind, you know, by severe cataract or something like that. And this elderly fellow, who was so old that he had wrinkles, inside his wrinkles, asked for my hand. I gave it to him. He put it between his hands and he said, young man, be faithful because God has many souls for you. And right there I learned that he was the pastor who founded that church. And that night he felt led to come to the building to hear a totally unknown preacher and to speak a prophetic word. I want you to pause for a moment now and let the Holy Spirit remind you of circumstances like that, where somebody, a pastor, your spouse, your parents, a child, somebody told you God has something in store for you. Having established that God has spoken to us, Now we need to realize that we could suffer shipwreck. And Paul says, I have a command for you. And this command includes keeping faith and a good conscience. Because some people have suffered shipwreck in regards to their faith because they overlook a clean conscience. How do I explain this? How do I understand this? Faith is a gift from God. That gift is given freely every day, like sunshine, like rain, you know, during a dry season. But you have to have a place to collect that, if it's water, or to reflect it, if it's sunlight. And that is our conscience. When you are first born, our conscience is very sensitive. Anything wrong, it reacts to it. Remember the first time you were tempted to do something evil, how everything in you revolted against that. Why? Because your conscience was immaculate at the time. But then if we begin to compromise along the way, well, I'm not sure it's so bad. Maybe I can try it for a while. Then we begin to suffer shipwreck. And it's very interesting, the word picture that Paul uses. In those days, you knew that a ship may have suffered shipwreck because you went to the port and waited for it long enough, and it never showed up. It was lost in the high seas, in a storm. No one saw it perhaps going down, but no one can see it coming to port. And this is what I find consistently. Time and again, when I visit a church or a city, and I ask about somebody that in my previous visit looked so promising, so full of faith, and people say, well, he's no longer around. We don't know what happened. But you know what happened? He or she suffered shipwreck because one day he overlooked the maintenance of a clean conscience. So my friend, there is such a destiny, such a hope, such a future that God has for you and the work that he has entrusted to you, that we better take good care of our conscience, that we keep short accounts, that if we hear God telling us that is no good, the evil one came to steal, to kill, to destroy, and he will use the flesh, the world, and sin. We better stop now before it contaminates everything. 98% holiness is not holiness. We have to have zero tolerance for sin. And I close with this illustration. When I was a brand new believer, and I began preaching on the streets of my native town in Argentina, I had an associate. He was my best friend. We did incredible things together. Actually, he was better than me, more anointed, bolder. I mean, even though I was his senior by 2 years, I really admired him. And I used to think, I am a Moses, but he's the Joshua. He will possess the land. He was so fearless, so anointed. And then when I came to the States to study, I came back. I went back to Argentina after several years. And he came to see me at the hotel. He said, Ed, I'm on my way to Australia. I no longer walk with God. And you know what? I don't miss him. I don't think he's real. That broke my heart. I tried, I pleaded with him. He said, no, it's not relevant anymore. Many years later, he went through a crisis, and I was able to come alongside him. And I say, and I spoke his name, when do you think you lost your faith? And he says, Ed, I remember clearly now when that was. It was when I went into business, and I remember vividly the first time that I cheated a customer. It wasn't a big thing, but it was like a tiny crack in a huge dam. I remember it. That was the day that my life took a turn for the worst. My friend, everybody begins strong. If a baby is not strong enough, it's not born alive. If a seed is not strong, it doesn't sprout. Beginning is not the test. The test is finishing strong. So I'd like to exhort myself and exhort you today. This is the year of the goodness of the Lord. He will move this bus. His bus is leaving the station. We better be on it. And to be on it, we need to keep short accounts. And if there is any sin, no matter how tiny, we better repent, confess it, receive forgiveness, and receive the power to walk in the holiness, in the power, in the beauty of holiness. I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus for the Holy Spirit now to empower you and me through a baptism of fire, so that that the devil has told us can never change, it will change by the power of God. Yes, receive it in Jesus' name. Amen.